Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Warm greetings to all you lovely people attending this live webinar. Today is a very special day for you, for our team, and for everyone here. Can anybody guess why it's so special? Yes, friends, because it's Mother's Day. So we, dentistchannel.online, wish all the mothers attending this live webinar and to all others out there a very happy Mother's Day. Let's put it in our dental language. A mother deserves a crown today and every day. Big thank you to all the mothers attending this live webinar. Today, we have a very special speaker, a very dynamic personality, Dr. Arpit Sikri. Dr. Arpit is currently working as a senior lecturer in the Department of Prosthodontics, Santosh Dental College, Santosh deemed to be University, Ghaziabad, Delhi. He had earlier worked as a senior resident in the most prestigious dental institute of the country, that is the Maulana Azad Institute of Dental Sciences, New Delhi, India. He is the youngest dental surgeon of India to complete his postgraduate diploma in hospital management from National Institute of Health and Family Welfare, New Delhi, India. And that too with a distinction. He has also been conferred with a diplomate fellowship in the field of implantology by World Congress of Oral Implantology, Tokyo, Japan. Throughout his academic career, he had been awarded with gold medals, being the topper of the university back to back. He has authored a book on oral pathology under Scientific MedTech Publishers. He has to his credit around 26 books under Lambert Academic Publishing and more than 100 national and international publications in various reputed journals. He is the editor of the WebMed Central, associate editor of Current Dental Research Journal, and the assistant editor of Asia Pacific Dental Journal and Eye Dentistry Journal. He is on the panel for various national and international journals as the editorial board member. Apart from this, he is also an active reviewer for various journals. He is actively associated with various organizations, namely the Indian Prosthodontic Society, IDA, IDRR, AHA, etc. He has presented keynote guest lectures and faculty presentations in various national and international conferences. He has also presented papers as well as poster presentations in various conferences, many of which were highly appreciated and awarded. He is also known for his organization skills and has been actively associated as an organizing committee member for various conferences. He is the council member of the Gregson-Lerman Group. He had been the president of the NDDSF Dental Society from Punjab State. He has also contributed in various books like the Textbook of Conservative and Restorative Dentistry, Textbook of Endodontics, Indirect Restorations, Target MDS MCQs, Dental Matrix, Brahmastra, AIMS 25, etc. He has also been conferred with many awards, namely the IDA Profile of the Month, Budding Dentist Award, Dental Youth Icon Award, Student Ambassador and Mentor by Publishing Group Elsevier, and the most recent, the Best Postgraduate Student in Prosthodontics in India. He has also won medals for various sports events held in conferences, intra-college as well as inter-college level. He's also a national level table tennis player and has won awards for the same. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Arpit. It's a pleasure to have you. Without much further ado, I now request you to kindly continue with the live webinar.
Thank you so much, Ruben, for the beautiful introduction. And I feel I am not such a big shot, but still, thank you so much. And a very good morning to my seniors, my friends, my colleagues, and my students. As Ruben said, I'm Dr. Arpit, currently working as senior lecturer in Santosh, deemed to be university, and I am really honored to be a part of it. Well, as said, I wish you Mother's Day today. It's a very special day, and I feel really blessed that I have dedicated this presentation to my mother, actually. So I'm really blessed to have, and I wish you the same. And this is Namaste for India, for friends and profession from Pan India, and greetings to all of you, to all the friends in profession. Well, I'm going to enlighten my knowledge on the topic, a new eye in prosthodontics, digital impressions, something very innovative, something new, something to be researched upon, and that is how I have gone about it. So, and whenever we start with any presentation, anything, I think nothing is complete without the knowledge, without goddess of knowledge, Mars Saraswati. So taking blessings of her, I'm starting with my presentation under the following headings. Well, just to introduce the topic, digital keyword is something which we are really well versed with. We are totally engrossed. We are totally obsessed with so much technologies, whether it's multimedia, digital marketing, online games, digital softwares, everything, is going digital. And I feel medical and dental fields are no less than the others. The dental field, the dental fraternity is also experiencing such great things, when we are talking about digitization in dentistry. So it has really done exceptionally well. It has taken dentistry to the next level. And, I am really honored to be a dental surgeon, for that matter, that dentistry, has been taken to greater heights with digitization. It has been an integral approach used. So, so many researchers come into picture. They came into play with the nomenclature. There were so many names which were given by various authors, since this topic has been researched extensively. And one such term, pause and resume impressions, is one of my favorites. That was a great term being given. And I call it impressions 2.0. I feel the conventional impressions, what we were taking, what we were making, is something different with the technology, what we are doing now. So technology is going really fast and emerging too. And I was really impressed when I saw that there have been so many index publications on this topic, and this topic has been extensively researched upon. So this is a great topic. There have been, apart from this, there have been some controversies, some people in favor, some people they are against. And that is how, this topic is a really hot one. Going back to the evolution, evolution is again very interesting. It all started with Patrick J. Henretty, who was actually the father of CAD-CAM, who actually introduced CAD-CAM. And definitely this was introduced into dentistry by this great man. I think salutations to this great man, Francois Druret, who during his time, he was doing a thesis, a dissertation on the topic optical impressions. So he was really instrumental. He was very keen to know how, apart from the impressions, what best we can do. So, he was burning the midnight candle to know how we join about the coordinates, how we make the scans. He took various scans, although those were two-dimensional scans. That was the two-dimensional picture. And this he further added with the, CAM milling. So he also saw how milling can be done from this subtractive manufacturing very well. And then he inserted and checked in the patient. So that's really commendable job which was done by him. This was followed by Werner Monbun, who was again instrumental in giving a CEREC design. So this was how CEREC evolved after Moorman and Bredesteny came up with the idea of CEREC 1, again, which was giving a 2D scan image. This led to further innovation by Anderson, who conjoined with Procera under Noble, and he also came up with the idea of 2D scans. And this was further marketed by Siemens as CEREC 2, with further innovations, more clarity of the image, more clarity of the impressions which were there. And this is how we got the CEREC 3 further with the in-house milling unit. And definitely we came up with CEREC 3, CEREC 3D, CEREC Blue Cam, AC Cam, and this was how, you know, innovation was going on and on and on. And that is how we moved from a 2D image to a more 3D image. I feel we should come up with a more 4D image too in near future. So this was how a tabulated form was there with different scanners which were being used, you know, and they had in-house milling units. Some were open systems, some were closed systems. So there were different principles for the same. So coming on to the component part, we generally use the term digital workflow. When we are going to fabricate any restoration, we are going to fabricate any processes, we usually deal with the digital workflow. The traditional workflow, as we can see in the picture, has, you know, so many steps. We have to go for the clinical steps. We have to go for the laboratory steps. And there should be a proper interplay of both. I feel digital is something, as it has been incorporated into the dental practice. So it has actually, you know, helped to reduce these steps to make the work more effective, to make the work more accurate. And this is the most common three component system which we use. I call it by the mnemonic SDM. So that is scan, design, and mill. So we have to scan with a portable scanner, which we have, either it's intraoral or extraoral. We have to go for, you know, once the scanning is done, we go for designing of the processes. And this is how, once we have finalized, we are confident enough with the processes, we go for manufacturing or milling of the same. And I was really mesmerized to see, this has been from a recent article of 2020 from a reputed journal. I came to know, even I didn't have knowledge of the same. So I came to know that apart from three component systems, we have four component systems. We go for scanning, we go for CAD software, and nowadays we have a CAM software too. So, you know, once milling is done, you can't go back. Obviously. So the best part is there is a CAM software which is enabled. Even there are slight rectifications which have to be done. So you can do in a better way. We have to, at the end, we need to be 100% accurate. That's our whole soul aim. And definitely these are three components, the scanning CAD software, the milling software, and then that's a numerically controlled data which helps in milling. Ultimate milling, it can be subtractive through CAM, the computer assisted machining, and it can be an additive manufacturing with the help of a 3D printer. That's quite interesting. I'll be taking that too. So that's how a handheld scanner is taken, starting from the most posterior aspect, coming on to the anteriors. And there and then you can also see whatever you are scanning on the computer screens. So that's a very good thing. If you are not, you know, confident about it, you can again go back, you can re-scan the impression. That's a beautiful technology what we are, you know, experiencing this time. And then we can, you know, we are not much concerned with the soft tissues. We are just concerned with the hard tissues. Whenever we are going with the diagnosis, we go for that. So we try with the lower model scanning, the upper model scanning, whatever we want to fabricate, we can go about that. Okay, we need to have a full scan. We can have a partial scan too. So once you have a scanning done, you take a bite alignment, so as to see the interocclusal picture properly, proper clearance for whatever processes you are making. And this can be aligned for further designing.
Start on the lower left buckle side of the most distal.
This is a scanning sequence. Whenever we start with, we try, mostly authors say, try and go about from the most posterior tooth. From the most posterior tooth at an angulation of 45 degree with a particular, you know, scanner, we can go about. We can start with, we can move in a zigzag manner. And as you can see, you can, you know, start from here, you can finish up till here. And from here again, you can start and finish. So there can be many patterns. It's up to you. The ideology is that you go about scanning. It should be good. It should be very clear. There should be no blurry images, hazy images, which should be there. So that can actually, you know, influence the final outcome of your processes. So that's very important. You use so many kind of sequences for scanning. And this is how various authors, they have devised various scan techniques. You can start from one, you know, you can go about the other. And this is a zigzag fashion. What we can use, generally, the authors, they prefer a zigzag fashion because they think that you'll get a better picture if you are capturing that with a zigzag manner. You can have a quadrant approach. Once you are going with a single tooth prosthesis, finalizing the prosthesis, you want to go for a single tooth scan, which is prepared. What you can do is you can just take a scan of only this thing. Okay. You can have a quadrant based approach. You can go by that. And that's a beautiful thing. You can have a sextant approach. No need to go for full arch scans if you feel that, you know, it is just a waste of time if you are going with that. So you can be very choosy. You can be very particular. It can be case based. So you can go about that, whatever you feel like. So this is further after we have gone with the scanning. What do we do is we go for a designing part. So computerized designing is done. As you can see, a single prepared crown. This goes into a software, and whatever preparation has been done, that's actually magnified. So you can have a zoomed in picture of whatever preparation has been done by the dental surgeon. The lab person can see that, can check the taper, can check the convergence angle. If any doubt, you can, you know, just converse with your the dental surgeon. There should be a proper dental lab communication. So once you have a crown which has been designed, there are so many designs which are available in the library, which is inbuilt, the digital library, which is inbuilt into the software. So that can be manufacturer based. So, you know, you can just check the finish line margins. You can check the axial proximal contours. You can check the buccolingual contours. And, you know, you can check the occlusal view. Once into occlusion, you see the fit is good. Everything is going well. The contours are fine. So you can go about, and you are confident enough, you can go further with the machining part. So this is how we go for, that's a ceramic ingot and a ceramic block. We take a ceramic block and we keep it in a CAM machine. We stabilize this block, maybe pre-sintered zirconia or a ceramic blank or a block. Whatever design now you have given for a single crown, it can be 3 unit, 5 unit, it can be full mouth bridges, whatever you have. So it will mill whatever you want to the fullest accuracy. And this is how you get the final processes which is required. So coming on to the classification systems, when I was going through books and, you know, articles, I found the classification to be really misleading. So what best I could do was I could jot down the classification. Now, generally the authors say it's intraoral or a direct or a chairside scan, and it can be extraoral, which is done in the lab. So they are lab-based scanners. It can be optical, it can be mechanical, and that is how we have different you know, scanners available with us with different manufacturers. We have a powdered scan. As you can see, this is a spray. So this is made of titanium dioxide, which helps in proper imaging. This came as an opti spray with Ceric Blue AC Cam, used quite earlier, and nowadays we don't prefer it because, you know, there are some biocompatible concerns. Some recent studies, they say that they can be cytotoxic at a very high concentration. And, you know, some patients are really allergic to it. So we really, you know, discouraged the use of the powdered scan, and that is how we went through a powder-free scan. Now, some systems can be closed system. They are quite conservative, and some are open systems. So open systems, they allow adoption of any, you know, any scan from any machine, any scan, you can just scan it, and through any milling unit, you can, you know, go for the milling of the processes. But in, closed scans, you are quite conservative. You have to use that particular manufacturer's things, scan, design, mill, and likewise that. And this is how, you know, whenever we are clicking pictures, we are having a JPG extension, JPEG, PNG, TIFF, we have, and so on. We have so many extensions, but this is not the case when you are making digital impressions. The files are generally stored as STL, standard tessellation file, or standard triangular file. There are certain other formats which are not very popular. That is OBG, object files, PLY, polymer files. and there are so many files which are available. So generally the STL files, they get stored, and that is how you can communicate with your lab. You can send the particular STL file, although it takes time, but nowadays the scanners, they are well equipped, that the data storage, the data transfer doesn't take much time to give this file to a lab personnel. And then we have extraoral lab scanners, and sometimes, you know, we don't have provision of intraoral scans. So what to do? You can't go without scanning. Then we have a well-equipped labs with lab scanners and proper in-house milling unit. And this is how, when you have made impressions, when you have given the cast to the lab person, this is how they can fix it. And this is, again, rotates once it is stabilized. This is how, you know, a blue light is coming, and this can scan in all the rotational planes. So you get a picture of the same. And this is one such method when you are doing a single implant case. Obviously, we prefer putty impression, polyethers, or vinyl polysiloxane, or a combination of two. We try to make the impressions, the conventional impressions. We have the impression analog. We pour the models, and that is being sent. The upper and the lower casts, they are sent to the lab. You can just pour it, you can send it. And this is how it looks like when you're doing conventionally. Now this model, if you don't have intraoral scan, this is the interarch relationship, interocclusion relationship. This goes inside with a cast fixture to stabilize both the cast, and you have a very good idea of the interocclusion, the upper and the lower alignment, everything. So you have a proper idea for this. Thereby you can go for designing and milling of your processes. And this was some from the Cerex scanners, which were earlier used. They were quite heavy. They were not as portable as they could be. So this was the initial innovation, which was done on a Typodont model. They, before experimenting, they also did some studies, some extensive studies on the Typodont model. And this was again by another manufacturer, Itero. Again, a very good, you know, manufacturer. You can have the view. And this was by Lava, chairside scanner. The blue light with a slow zigzag scanning. That's also a very good thing, because with a zigzag scanning, generally the authors, they recommend a zigzag scanning to have a clear picture of the same. And coming on to the advantages, I think digital impressions, it's totally advantageous, what I feel. But yes, there are certain disadvantages. So let's take them one by one. So that is how it makes me to the topic, why are we using? So why is a big question? It's a big question why we are using digital impressions. So this reminds me of a time when I was a third year student. I did my case, my first case I did. And you know, it reminds me of this person, the eighth impression, not bad. So if I go back to the older times, supposedly, you know, there was a story for that. And, you know, I was really frustrated with the kind of conventional impressions I was making. And the same day I went back and my father asked me, do you want to do MDS? So I go, yes, I want to do. So what's your choice? My father asked me, what's your choice? So I told him the last choice is prosthodontics. I was really frustrated, you know, and that time probably I thought that I'll do something in prostho. I'll take prostho only now. And that is how it came up to my mind that I should search something on digital impressions. And maybe at that point of time, if I could have provision of the same, and I was, you know, well versed with that particular situation, I would be quite interested to do that. So there were certain problems which are associated. We are reading in dental materials to the detail that there are so many limitations, and we keep on saying, what is the ideal impression material? I say up till now, there is no ideal. There is nothing idealism. So there is no ideal impression material. Whatever conventional impression materials we follow, they are associated with some pros and cons. And that is how we all go about. So the best part, the lovely part of the digital impressions or the intraoral scans is that they are dimensionally quite accurate. And there had been so many studies done for the same picture to just check the comparison between digital and the conventional impression materials and techniques to check the dimensional accuracy. And we say the first and the very first requirement of any impression material is it should be dimensionally stable. So I found nothing to be dimensionally stable. In fact, I would say that the digital impressions also can be made more stable, which I'll show you how. So the tendency to rescan the impression, it is quite frustrating to know that when we are making impressions, we are sending it to the lab. So sometimes, you know, there are certain errors, there are certain flaws which are associated with the conventional impression materials. And that is how when we, you know, coordinate with the lab person, they may send us the impression back. But the best part or the beautiful part of this technology is that we can, if you feel you have a blurry image, you have something which is very hazy, what you can do is you can again go back, you start with the lower scan, you start with the upper scan, you can go for the bite alignment, and that is how you can rescan the impression. It takes maybe less than just 2 minutes to rescan the same. So the technology is, you know, beautiful. Then there are no manipulation issues. There is no need to dispense the impression materials, no need to call if you don't have a backlog for the impression materials. There is no worries, you know, that's the best thing. No need to go for any manipulation part, nothing. It's simple, just scan, design and mill. There is no need of any trace, no inventory required, nothing required. And that's the best thing, what you have. Obviously, when you don't have any tray, no conventional, no custom tray, you can directly go with the, you know, with the scanning part. There is no need for any physical impression, no need of any wastage of the material. There is no need. This is particularly pertaining to the orthodontists who, you know, try to keep the record of the orthodontic study models. So sometimes, you know, when we just go back and just check the model, sometimes they are broken, sometimes the casts are not up to date, they're full of dust, and you know, that doesn't look good. So the best part is the stored data, it goes into the software which you have. And I was you know, really feeling good. We can actually broaden our horizon by saying that actually we can scan for some study, for a survey. We can do a study, we can, you know, go for some checking the mass disaster patients, the identification of the disaster patients. That is, that can be used as an aid for forensic identification too. So that is how we can, you know, broaden the arena of intraoral scans. We cannot go for storage of the cast, but we can go for storage of the data. There is no wastage of material. Much of the material is sometimes wasted. We have to go for making materials again and again. And there are some issues related to the patient. In fact, if we are quite skillful, sometimes we are not able to make the impressions because we need somebody who is very compliant and cooperative. So if we don't have one, we have a definitely negative patient, I think we'll go for wastage of packets and packets of the impression material. So this is not the scene, what we see in intraoral scans. There are no disinfection issues. We go for, you know, Cydex, we go for Idofors, we go for sodium hypochloride. And particularly this time, since we are in a situation where when we are more concerned with the disinfection, I think the disinfection plays a greater role in the conventional impression materials and techniques, wherein there are chances of some dimensional inaccuracies to be, you know, acquired into the impression material. So this is the best part when we talk about the intraoral scans. What you need to do is you are using RVG, you use the plastic sleeves. The plastic sleeves are quite disposable ones. You can use the plastic sleeves. They are very well given to you by the manufacturer. And you can, you know, just use it for one time for one patient, and then you can dispose it off. So that's the best part you can do. You can use the sleeves. There is no damage to cast. Obviously, you are not having any record of the proper, you know, cast. Then there is no need for these casts. And it actually helps to build effective communication. This is very important for the success of your clinical practice. I can't say if I am a successful dental surgeon and I'll do everything on my own. It can't happen. So I need to have a very good lab support. I need to have a very good lab coordination. If it is there, it's always a teamwork. I love to work as a team. So if it's a team-based approach, we can grow well, we can do wonders, we can do, you know, we can progress to the maximum. So see, sky is not the limit, but I feel that yes, we can have a very good communication, we can have a good skills with the lab personnel. Once and all, you have impression, you have made the impression, you send it to the lab personnel in an STL file. If you feel, you can just coordinate with the lab person. If it is not correct, you know, what you can do is you can again rescan the impressions. So this is how you can, you know, frequently coordinate, you can frequently communicate with the lab personnel in a very good way. And this builds a very good rapport with the lab. And no more, you know, the lab techies now can't, with due respect, they can't tell you that the margin is short, there are flaws in your impressions. So it is how we play like a team, we grow as a team. And this is what I was telling you, the data storage is very good. And definitely it's a good thing as far as we want to do some epidemiological studies or we want to go for research on some identification in particularly disaster management patients. We have to identify the victims. So if you have the data, it's beautifully virtually secured into your computers, into your laptops. So there and then you can see. So I was going through this slide and I thought we go for digital shared matching. We have shared matching also. We have very good tools with us. But then I think we will be coming up with the shared matching softwares, which are inbuilt into the scanner. So we have a provision of matching the shared as accurately as possible to give a natural appeal, to give beautiful results to the patient. And definitely it's a boon for those patients, particularly who are potential gaggers, who have vomiting reflexes. So, alginates, I really hate that because majority of the patients, they come up and they have the retching reflex. So just to avoid the gagging, the gag reflex, that's the best answer to your question that is coming much above this disadvantage of the conventional impression material. No need of going for any, maintenance of the Facebook components, maintenance of this kind of face bows, no physical face bows, no physical articulators required, no need to go for maintenance of the components. You have a proper inbuilt virtual articulator wherein if you want to go for a fabrication of a balance denture, you can go with it. The best part is you can just note down the readings, Bennett movement, anything you want to, you just note down the readings and based on that you can go for the final fabrication of the processes. The preference part, generally, the studies have been done in pan-Indian countries and it has been found that the patients really prefer. Now they are again aware as we are. So there has been quite awareness and I think there should be more awareness in our country too. It is coming up, but it is less as of now. So there should be more preference as per what patients say. Patients rightly come and they say, I want this. I don't want to, give impression. Also, once and all, it is just like an addiction. So patient is quite addict to your, intraoral scanner and doesn't want much more from the conventional impression materials. And in fact, this is a very good thing. The students, I was going through some, these articles, they say that in pan-Indian countries, the foreign countries, they have universities with well-equipped scanners. And this is taught to them as a part of pre-clinical curriculum. So I think it should come up in our country also, we and students and, we can motivate the patients, we can motivate our students to be oriented towards the latest technologies, the latest advents. And this would be really good as per the society. And we talk about the preference towards children. So generally, it's very difficult to manage the pediatric patients. And this is how, this is for the periodontists who want to manage, who have, who can invest, who have provision of intraoral scans. That is a magic to the child. And it's very difficult. If I am a child, I won't allow anybody to take impressions of my mouth. And in some situations, you want to take impression and that can be used as one of the parts of behavior management protocols. Now in these patients, it was found that it is really comfortable to the children, the pediatric patients, and this is how the technology goes and speaks. Quite efficient, convenient, as you know, nowadays, the kind of equipment or the kind of, technology that is coming is more portable, is more doctor friendly, patient friendly. So the kind of technology, that is very dynamic, that keeps on changing. And it's all about the efficiency. It improvises your efficiency. There is no need to go for a lab work. You are doing clinical work. You are again doing a lab work. So it's so laborious, particularly for a prosthodontist. I can understand the feeling of a prosthodontist that you have to work and you have to do both the things, vice versa. So the best part is you just take a scan that is more efficient and improvises. You can work as a team for that too. And the best part, the fit of the processes, if there are no marginal discrepancies, that's the best part. If the finish line has been recorded properly, obviously the retraction has been done, everything has been done as per the protocols, I feel the fit, the marginal fit, in case of cobalt chrome all metal crowns, it can be lithium disilicate, the IPS Empress 2, they are doing wonderfully well. Then the PICN, polymer infiltrated crowns, ceramic crowns, or the enamic, the ceramic composite crowns, whenever we want to just check the fit, we see, we check the fit, and definitely it has been found through so many studies that the metal ceramics, all ceramics, every system, zirconias, everything, they are doing wonderfully well. It is highly appreciated the way we are getting the processes from the lab, we are fabricating the restorations, and that speaks for yourself. That speaks to you, the kind of work we are doing, that that actually is a mantra for you know, maintaining a successful dental practice, and that I think that can mint you money like anything. So the all ceramics, what I was talking to you about, and when you are talking about the time, we have the inbuilt system. So we start with the lower impression. Always we say start with the lower one. So we take a lower scan, and you can see just the time. So time is, you know, it's not a big issue. If you are well versed with the technique, if you have knowledge, you are quite updated, and I feel you can do wonders if you have the digital impression technology with you. So you start with the upper scan, the upper jaw scan. Once you complete it, and see, in no time, you know, you are getting wonderful impressions. These are, I would say, the next level impressions you are getting with this. So once and all, you are going with the scanning. You can scan the soft tissue, but that is not required. This is as per case based. If you feel they can be, it can be done. But yes, the idea is to just show you that it doesn't take so much of time to scan the areas. And that is how we go about it. So as I told you, it eliminates, when we compare the conventional and the digital systems, I feel there are so many steps, there are so many procedures, the clinical lab-based procedures, which are being involved and have to be dealt with you. So that decreases your efficiency. But yes, when I compare it with the kind of steps, with the so less number of steps, I have to just go for 3 steps if I see SDM. So I have to go for either a scanning, designing, milling, or then maybe a 4 component system, but the steps are drastically reduced as compared to the conventional impressions. Well, that's again a magic and a boon for particularly patients who have limited mouth opening. They can be coming from, you know, various etiologies. They may have particularly the chronic tobacco chewers, the oral submucous fibrosed patients, and definitely there can be so many etiologies for that. But what we are concerned with is that a 0 number tray, shortest possible tray, even cannot go into the mouths of the macrostomic patient because of the limited mouth opening. So what we can do is, a scanner is very small, it's very handy, and nowadays scanners, they are coming in very small sizes, and they're quite lightweight. So the best part is you can there and then scan the impression for any partial or a complete prosthesis, whatever required. And again, a very good thing, there is no radiation hazard. No need to give unnecessary, you know, radiation exposure to your patients. This is particularly coming up as a boon to the pregnant patients, particularly because we say that radiation exposure has to be minimized. So once in all, when you check, you want to check the implant, and you want to do a particular follow-up for the osseointegration through the radiographs, and you want to check the, you know, position and angulation, it is going, you know, there and then it is going fine. Okay, then what you can do is you can go for a scan for just the position and angulation of the same. No need to go for radiographs there and then. That can be used as one of the techniques just to avoid the radiation exposure. So this is one of the new techniques wherein they say that even we can just check and diagnose the caries, any caries exposure, caries, crack detection. So nowadays, the, you know, the scanners, they are very well equipped with a kind of technology, no more radiations. We are going well against the radiations. We want to minimize the exposure to the radiation. And that is what ALARA principle says. So we want to reasonably, you know, decrease the level of radiation what we have. So that's the best part what we can do. And that's a great innovation. Apart from, you know, so many advantages, every coin has 2 aspects. So again, we have pros, we have cons. So let's see what are the disadvantages. We have a steeper learning curve. That means you can't say that I have done a patient with the scanner. Now I'm like a king. You have to be well versed with the technology. The technology is rapidly growing, and you know it is evolving like anything. There are so many scanners. They are coming up. They are changing. They are updating. And as I told you, the research is extensive. So I feel the learning curve, the way you need to be, you know, updated with the technology, not only you, and definitely you will feel that your patients are also updated with this technology. So you need to read, you need to be well oriented with the kind of technology which we are using. So that is a good thing. So it takes time to develop skills. Any technology comes in, we definitely we have to give sufficient time. We need to be well versed with the technology. We need to do, you know, more R&D research development for that. The operating field, yes, that's very important aspect. Don't feel that we are doing moisture control only in the conventional impressions. We are very well, you know, concerned when we have moisture, we have to, you know, control the saliva. We have to use ideal isolation protocols. We have to go for moisture control, and particularly the gingival fluids may also obscure the kind of field you have. So if you want to scan, make sure it should be a very dry field. There should be no gingival fluids. And if you don't have, you won't be able to record the finish line margins. And that is how we are, you know, associated with the success of the finish line placement, the margin placement, the marginal fit. And I feel personally that it should be a dry field. There should be no reflective surfaces. So all these things, you know, the scanner, actually, when you are going to scan any area which is full of moisture, which is full of saliva, it is not controlled. The ideal isolation has not been performed. So what will happen is that will definitely give you a blurry image, a hazy image. So that is not good for the final, you know, outcome of the processes. The lab support, you know, it's not you are having an intraoral scanner and your lab personnel doesn't have anything. What you will do is not to just fetch images of the patient. You need to have a very well integrated lab support with a good chairside scanner with well inbuilt lab, which is fully equipped, which has all sorts of, you know, newer generation technologies associated with them. The other disadvantage what I came across was the digital scan technology is very good as far as we are, you know, concerned with the shorter span restorations. We want to go for a single tooth scan. We want to go for maybe 3-unit, 4-unit. But when we go for generally full mouth implants, full mouth, single implants, full mouth reconstruction cases, there were certain technicalities which were involved. So full mouth, generally, when we, you know, go about the longer span restorations, we are really concerned with that. So we need to deal with this situation, although the technologies are still, the area is researched upon, and one day definitely we'll come up with some magical technology with us. And implant impressions, it's, you know, quite technical to record the implant impressions because you need to have a scan body, and there are certain angular and linear deviations between the scan body and the kind of customized abutment you are using. Another protocol was this soft tissue scanning. You are recording whatever you are recording the teeth, you are recording the heart tissues. That's fine. You are getting a very good process is, but what about soft tissue scanning? Now the concern was when you are, you know, going for the digital dentures, the computerized dentures, what to do? The soft tissue scan, you know, we are really very much concerned when we say the mucocompressive, mucostatic, and the selective pressure techniques. Now these techniques play a greater role and with the tissue dynamics which is involved. And you know, we are not playing with the mucoperiosteum. Whatever we are recording the soft tissues, they are at rest. So it was found that the saliva is full on the edentulous ridges, and it's not very easy because you are not getting a sufficient functional width and depth of the borders, what you can achieve with your border molding. So we'll see how we can deal with this situation. And a very important situation is the economical concerns. What do we feel? That is, you know, investment is much. You need to have a lot of investment. You need to have, you know, the cost incurred for the data you are recording is as per the annual basis. So what we can do is we can go for a combination approach. We can go for conventional impression as of what you can do is if you feel the full mouth cases and whatever cases, full mouth implants you are doing, you can go for the conventional impression procedures. And what you can do is you can there and then scan the impression. But the idea is it shouldn't have some deeper depths or deeper undercuts, because the scanner will not be able to record that. So with the help of a lab scanner, we can actually scan the impression also. But then that needs to be dimensionally stable. It should be of VPS or VPES, ideally. So if we are using a combination approach, I think we are solving quite a lot of queries which we have. So indications, I feel the digital technology has a very vast, this promising tool is doing wonders, and the trends are growing. And I feel the arena is really wide. It's a very wide horizon, which includes so many subjects. Now it has included everything: removable, fixed prosthodontics, implants, maxillofacial, full mouth reconstructions, the temporomandibular joint, as far as the aesthetics is concerned, everything, everything is included. So this is how the digital technology is not limited to one subsection of prosthodontics. It has involved everything. So that is how we go about. And most commonly, we use the computer-engineered complete dentures, the digital dentures. But herein, we go for a two-step denture. We try to make impressions with the, specialized trays and anatomic measuring devices. So there and then, we record the primary secondary impressions with a tentative centric relation. We send it to a lab wherein we have a virtual teeth arrangement, because we have the intraocular scan, the intra-space scan. So there and then we can go for the virtual arrangement. And also subsequently, once the arrangement is done, this is how we go for a 3D printed denture. That's a good thing. We can go for it. It saves a number of appointments for the patient, and that is how the technology goes. Another beautiful thing, scanning of the soft tissues, but yes, I think the results are not that good. They are not favorable. We should ideally use a combination approach, which I'll show you how. So you have a base, a virtual base, and definitely you have a model. Months in, you have completed the virtual arrangement. You go in for the milling part. So milling, again, the kind of dentures, the two-step dentures which you are giving to the patient, they are quite precise. They are quite accurate. You are giving something. You are giving a magical processes to the patient. So this improvises the comfort, the level of, your patient will appreciate you a lot and give you blessings for that. And sometimes we also go, now we don't want to, we try to make the custom trays, the customized trays or the special trays. And we see there has been, using resin, polymer, monomer, and we just want to avoid the possible unwanted effects of the monomer. So what we do is we can even fabricate the 3D printed custom trays. The idea is it is very stable. It can be made on the desktop, and therein it can be printed. It's a 3D printed tray, and on that you can use. So this is how you use the technology also. This is how you use the conventional approach also. If you can't go by this technique, you can use a handful of situations are there wherein, we are stuck up. So we can use a 3D printed trays to just reduce the amount of distortion, and we can have very well accurate impressions, which can be later on scanned. And this is how we can also go if the existing denture is fine. If this is, the vertical dimension is maintained, what you can do is there and then you can reline those dentures. You can do border molding. You can do, the relining can be done, and maintaining the interocclusal spaces or the VD on that maintained vertical dimension. What you can do is you can just scan the elastomeric impression, which is stable one. And then therein you can go with the jaw relations and with the virtual teeth arrangement. This is how we can use the existing denture too, with a combination approach. And another beautiful thing, integrated approach. Nowadays, we are having mobile phones, Androids, which are, which are having some apps, facial scan apps. They can scan the face. And in the coming eras, we'll have, something more better than what we have now. So we can scan the perioral tissues, we can scan the, we can have the nasal scans, we can have the facial scans, and we use the integrated, all these scans with the intraoral scan, just to have the idea what my patient will look like, what kind of aesthetics my patient will have, and something. It's again an emerging tool as far as the digital technologies are concerned, and that is doing exceptionally well. You can go for tooth supported overdentures as and when required, again, which can be 3D printed, they can be milled. Going for the single dentures, again, if you have opposing denture, you can just take a scan, just superimpose it, and you can have the image of that, and beautifully you can go for with the fabrication of the single denture. And there are certain situations when some patients have some congenital syndromes. So syndromic patients can also be, you know, very well treated with such kind of emerging trend. So this is good. Papillon-Lefebvre syndrome is one such study which I was reading. So there is, you know, huge amount of bone loss and teeth. They are just exfoliating. There are multiple deciduous teeth and immature permanent teeth. So they tend, you know, we can just plan an immediate denture over and there over the virtual cast. So in such patients also, we can do wonders. And, you know, it's very pathetic to again and again make impressions for these patients. We really feel pity for patients, but that is really unfortunate for these patients. So why not to give them a fortunate technology which you have, which is a magic for you. So this is good. Ultimately, you can give a denture, immediately plan to the patient, and subsequently you can go for further follow-ups if required. The cast partial processes is, again, you are making the cast partial processes again with a 3D printed approach, with a scanner, with a 3D printed approach, is again doing wonders. So once and for all, you are giving adequate respect to all the components of your cast partial, the major minor connectors, rest, indirect direct retainers, the denture bases, the finish lines, external, internal, everything. You have the shape, you have to, you know, scan, likewise the kind of processes you want to give, the interdental areas, everything, you know, it can be scanned there, and then you can sculpt the kind of processes you want to give. And this is actually exceptionally doing well. Although, you know, we are not doing quite a lot of cast partials. We have resorted more towards implantology. But I think, I feel, if we give such kind of cast partial frameworks and use this kind of technology, I think we are doing more than enough what we want to do. So that is a good thing. That's pretty good. You finalize the scan, you design, you finalize it, and this goes for milling. And definitely nowadays we have another material which is known as polyether ether ketone peak. So they say if metallic frameworks, they are not suitable, they are not you know, very well accepted by the patients, what you can do is you can give a peak framework which is quite comfortable, which is quite, you know, patient friendly, doctor friendly, and it is giving exceptional result. The only thing what I felt was the cost factor, and I think furthermore research can be done on this topic, because we can give peak frameworks, that will be a, you know, very good option for the patients to come, and they maybe then and there they'll plan to get more cast partials as per and as compared to the other kinds of processes. And we generally use selective laser melting. This is a kind of 3D printed approach to go on for the fabrication of the processes. So that is a very good technology and giving exceptionally good results. And another thing, we do altered cast technique. This is one of the innovation. What you can do is, again, you use an integrated combination approach with conventional materials and your intraoral scans. So with the distal extension approaches, we need to make some kind of, we need to do some modifications. We need to take the digital, the dual arch, the dual impressions. And that is how we can go about. What we can do is we can just fabricate the 3D tray on a virtual model. And then and there, we can just make the impressions of the this altered cast, and then simultaneously to take an interocclusal record too. For the fixed dental processes, again, if it's a short span processes, single units, commendable job being done by the digital impressions. And there have been reviews, there have been systematic reviews and meta-analysis. So how well and beautifully the digital impression techniques are doing wonders, particularly if we are talking in terms of the fixed partial processes. And this is how we used to go, you know, it is a very tedious job to make the custom tray, particularly when we are making a custom tray for fixed partial impressions. And I think it is really tedious. It's really cumbersome because you land up into distortion of the impression material. Ultimately, some trays are thick, they are thin, and it's, you know, quite difficult to be dealt with. So the nowadays scanners are coming up with a beautiful Boolean effect, where and when they can, you know, just give you uniformity with your 3D custom trays. You can get technology from digital scans, and you can likewise make impressions from the conventional approach. If it's a long span restoration, if it's a short span, then no need to go for the integrated approach. There and then directly you can go with impressions with the intraoral scans. the inlays, onlays, veneer, laminates, I think beautifully, for particularly for the aesthetic conscious patients, you want to give the ultra conservative preparations which were given earlier. They are also being researched upon. And nowadays we are going more towards a full coverage restorations. So if we talk about the laminates, they have, you know, supragingival finish margins. I think there is no need for obviously subgingival, because the pathway is obscured with the digital scan, since there are gingival fluids. So you won't see such kind of thing. Since you are giving a supragingival finish margin, you can very well go for, but you have to maintain a very dry field. You have to respect the field. You have to dry it, and then you can go about with the impressions. So another thing is the provisionalization. The temporary restorations, again, can be given with this beautiful integrated approach. So what we can do is, we have the models with us. If we have the models, we can, with ourselves, if we are quite skillful, that we can make it, then we can make it on our own, or we can take help from the lab, which is very well equipped. What we can do is, we can just have a zoom in scan of the restoration. I'm sorry, for the preparation, what you have done, you can just check. And there and then you give temporaries or the interim crowns, particularly for the interiors, as you can see, because a patient, it's a social stigma. Patient can't move out without these temporaries or the interim crowns. So there and then you can go for the milling part. And there, if you feel you have a crown which has defective margins, quite a long time back, patients come, you can remove the defective crown. You can go for the preparation part. I'm just going hurriedly because almost 1 hour has gone, and I'm just going to finish it in another 5 minutes. You go for suitable placement of the retraction cords. And there and then, once subgingivally you check retraction cord placed, you are respecting the tissues, you are going more gently. I feel you are scanning beautifully, starting with the restoration, lower scan, upper scan. And this is how you get the interocclusal record. No need to go for any particular interocclusal material. You have a beautiful technology, make use of it to the fullest. You can just scan, design. This is all, you know, this is how milling goes. From a block, subtractive. Idea is to go more for layered by layered manufacturing. The unglazed trial is done, then the glazed, you know, we just check the prosthesis. And definitely, it's a blind faith that it would give you best results. Coming on to the implantology, again, the procedure is again technical. It is tedious to record the digital impression. But whenever we do it, we always go for dynamic navigation surgery. Never go with a freehand surgery. Try the best possible way is you go for fabrication of a surgical template in every case. Now, this is the best thing. Although if you are skillful, that's a different thing. But if you are a beginner, then always start with the fabrication of surgical template. You have a 3D CBCT scan of the bone, everything you have with you. And then you can have an intraoral scan of the surgical template. Once and all, you have the template with you. It is designed. It is there with you. You can actually superimpose the intraoral scan of the surgical template with the CBCT scan of the bone. So once in, it is superimposed. This superimposed data, which you can see, goes here. And you can check in all planes. You can check what is my height, what is my angulation. You can see, this is how the virtual implant planning, the diagnosis, you know, starts with everything virtual. So this is how the 3D planning goes with fabrication of a suitable template. And there and then you can, you know, play, go for placement of the implants in the specified locations with the better accuracy, with better positions and angulations, and which will, you know, give you beautiful results. This is how the surgical template goes. Some of the pictures I have just jotted down in different cases. And that's a workflow. What we do, we generally, you know, go for scan body. So scan body is again a kind of a component only. Once in, you remove the healing abutment, you try to place the scan body into that particular place where you can place the impression analog. So you place the intraoral scan body, which can be seen greater in height, and then it has the provision to give you the best possible accuracy for the impressions to be recorded always. So it comes up as per whatever manufacturer or as per whatever implant system you are using. So you can go about with the scanning of intraoral scan body. You can have the scan, upper, lower arch, bite scan. This is how the scan body comes. The only thing is the kind of abutment you are using, customized abutment, milled abutment. There can be some deviations and your scan body can be rounded off. It can be veered and teared off. So just make sure it should be fresh. It should be placed nicely. It will give you accurate results. But this is how it all goes with the designing of the crown. This is a tie base given in situations where you have decreased intraocclusal space. Again, with the scan body. So the idea is to use a peak scan body with a peak implant material. Although again, research is going on this topic. We are moving more from titanium to a peak substance, peak based. So this is how they say more accuracy you want to have in implant cases, you have to go for a peak implant, peak scan body. That will give you, good results, which will be really good for the final processes. This is how the implant supported FDPs we are fabricating, the customized abutment kept designed for the interiors to make sure be very gentle with the tissues, try to respect the emergence profile, because interiors you have to give good aesthetic outcomes. Even in cases with immediate implant placement, wherein you have extraction of the offending teeth and using all those strategies, augmentations, whenever you feel after the healing collar you have a sufficient this gingival collar with you. The best part is you can use a combination of a healing abutment or a healing collar with intraoral scan body. So that is also an integrated approach. A recent article says that you can have the milled framework of titanium with the hybrid denture. Again, you can go for implant supported overdentures with all sorts of, what I told you in complete dentures, computer engineered complete dentures with a combination or an integrated approach with us. Then maxillofacial patients, maxwax patients, it's very difficult and it's very pathetic to really injure those patients and give more trauma to these patients. Already, it's really unfortunate. So we go for fabrication of the prosthesis, auricular, eye, any kind of prosthesis. You can just scan. You can go for a facial scan, a facial prosthesis in cleft palate and lip patients. It's again doing wonders. So you have these patients wherein you want to give normal functions to the baby, to the infant, to the small child. And another thing which is again doing well, which is recent, is the pre-surgical nasoalveolar molding, wherein we give a palatal plate, a feeding plate is given. But if you use conventional impressions, you land up in giving a prosthesis which is really traumatic to the patient. You can't go for impressions again and again in these patients, and then it can also lead to aspiration of the impressions in the oronasopharyngeal cavity. So make sure you are doing, dealing with the scans in a good way. You are dealing with the craniofacial anomalies, all thanks to the wonderful technology. It's doing wonders for each and every patient. The obturator prosthesis, wherein you can give a 3D printed obturator prosthesis after scanning, and definitely in full mouth reconstructions you can scan, but generally it's not too easy to scan the areas with full mouth. So you can use an integrated approach. The jaw tracking in temporomandibular joint, we read about the mandibular movements, so we can just check the movements, mandibular movements, the immediate side shift, precurrent shift, and progressive shift, everything. We can just check the movements, protrusive, incisive, left, right, lateral, all the movements we can check. And we can just check it for diagnosis. Supposedly patient has some temporomandibular issues with him or her. So what we can do is, we can just check what kind of processes we want to give. We want to actually remove the offending agent. And the best part is what we say is, in fact, giving a 3D occlusal splints. We also fabricate occlusal splints, but then avoiding the wastage of material, everything. We need to go for a digital workflow for occlusal splints just to characterize the bite and CRCO relationship. And this is again, when you have the upper and lower scan, I'm just going hurriedly. over the virtual articulator. You just plan. You plan the extent of your occlusal splint. That is very important. You can just cut in and you can just see what best possible you can do. And there and then you can keep and go for designing and milling of the splint. The digital smile design, it's again doing wonders as by coachman. And definitely you have patients who, you know, you send, they send pictures to you. They say it's, you know, I'm not looking good. I'm not aesthetically going fine. So what you can say, you have a very good technology in the form of digital smile design, wherein you have a well built thing with you, wherein, you know, you can just go by the principles of smile design. You can just show the final outcome, what it looks like. And the best part is patient has to use just an Android phone to give you a picture. But yes, nowadays we are coming up with the better versions of the phones, Androids, iOS. So the best part is the images coming are really good. We have a facial scan apps. We have different apps. So we can just superimpose the data of the phone with the intraoral scan. And that way also we can go about with the scanning or the smile analysis of the patient. So see, if you motivate your patient in such beautiful way, I think it will, you know, make your, it will give you a boon to your practice. Your, it needs to be there for a successful dental practice. It will mint you money like anything. So again, for the post-end course, endodontically, the post-course, ideally we are concerned with the fit. We are concerned with the ferrule effect. Everything, we can see the post-space impressions. We can just record the post-space impressions, go in for a CAD-CAM post, whatever required, and there and then we can go for a final analysis. So the not only prosthodontics, I feel the orthodontists, again, they are doing wonder. The scanning part can be again used for the digital orthodontic study model for model analysis and can be used for clear aligner therapy. Even the endodontists, they are using it. So it is, you know, it's a multitasking approach. It's just like a team. It's digital dentistry. We are doing wonderfully well in our own fraternities. So that is a good part if you are doing this. Well, I was amazed that what will happen in 2050, what will be the futuristic considerations, what we are going to do. I think the technology is so emerging, that is emerging rapidly. I think it should be 2030. The technology is growing so well. So I was telling you about the subgingival preparations and impression. We are not able to make good impressions. We have blurry images if we are making subgingival impressions with the intraoral scans. So we have a provision of ultrasonic impressions where we use the acoustic sound waves, but this is not a topic which is quite researched upon. I could see only one or two articles. And this is something with the help of vibrations, we can just scan those particular areas. Quite innovative in the medical field. And nowadays, I think we would be coming up with such ultrasound or ultrasonic impressions in near future. The artificial intelligence, as we all know, the future is artificial intelligence. So I feel there will be a time when, you know, a combination of human and robotic stimulations will help us in fabricating a good restoration, good design. So if you can see, this is from a digital library of already stored intraoral softwares. But this is a neural network, which is quite good from artificial intelligence. Again, this area needs to be researched upon. Particularly, I'm concerned more with prosthetics. Then we have a micro CT scan, which is again coming up. We have a big micro CT is used in other medical fields, other fields. But then scanning the impression is again, a study is going on in Tokyo, Japan. And from wherein we can go for, again, with something which is going to be a magic. Let's see what it comes. And this was, again, another technology, dimensional QC, wherein you have some blurry image. So if you have crowns, the artificial intelligence or the softwares will tell you whether they are 100% accurate or there has been some loophole in the crowns. So if there is some problem, some error, it will give you such blurry effect into your prosthesis. So that's a good technology. Again, has to be researched upon. The photogrammetry, as I told you, the photographic scans, intraoral photography with suitable, you know, DSLRs, with some 3D images, with some suitable apps or scanners will give you, or, you know, you'll get such technology, which is again beautiful. You'll get super added effects with two technologies. So you have a photogrammetric device with, again, intraoral scanner. You superimpose picture one, picture two, and you have the final picture, which gives you a better idea than intraoral scanning alone. So we can use, again, we can come up with such technology to be researched upon. Another thing, the virtuality reality concept of implantology, where VR AR concept is really coming up. We have the gestures, we have hands-free, we have a drilling mode, and whatever we are doing, everything we know, we are doing it quite well. We have the drilling mode, implant mode, and it is all suitably selected. This is one of the research being done on a Typodon model. So let's see, this also comes, it will do wonders. So it will take some time. So virtuality reality concept is again rapidly growing interest. The research is again actively going on this topic. The robotic implantology, again, there was a study when 2 years back when, robots placing implants in less than half an hour. So maybe another such good technology apart from the digitization, we have the nanorobotics coming up, the robotic dentistry. This is all, this is a visual thinking. But we always, we are a well-wisher. We want that this should come and giving you suitable, predictable results. This is how it all goes. Just a small video. You have a real-time situation, simulation there and then, you can go with. And this will also tell you whether you are going into any anatomy, any nerve, anything which is anatomical consideration. So that way also you'll get to know if I'm going right, I'm going wrong, I'm going, I'm parallel to the long axis, I'm going into the bone, I'm not going into the nerve, anything. So this will give you a real-time patient tracking, bone tracking. You'll have a real-time tracking of the bone. That is, what more you want. This way, implantology will be doing wonders. So definitely I welcome you to the future. We have seen so much, and maybe, a time will come when even we can just, we will be able to, scan through the wet field, no more issues with the dry field, and we will be able to, go for scanning of the erosive measurements, erosions, other non-carious defects. And that is what I was feeling we'll be coming up with more handy. We will be taking up an equipment wherein we would be needing, we will be placing it into our pockets, and that would be more portable. We'll be having such handy equipments in the time to come, the next level digitization, which is going to come. And that is what I wanted, the intraoral milling concept. I feel there must be a time when we would be able to, click a picture from mobile, and there and then only we'll be able to mill the prosthesis in no time. Well, that's a vision. I think it's a visual thinking, but we'll definitely see that time. To be on a positive note, we'll definitely see it that time. And with the concluding remarks, I must say there are certain takeaways for you, certain take-home messages of what we have, we have discussed. And definitely we are moving from gradually, there has been a paradigm shift from analog to a digital approach. We are moving from conventional to digital impressions. But my conventional impression techniques and the materials which are used, don't straight away go to the digital impression, start scanning, and don't be overreacting and overexcited. So whenever we go and move into a new technology, we should be well versed with the conventional technology too. Wherever possible, nowadays we are using powder free systems. No need to go for a powdered systems, which are not quite, they are not patient friendly. And what I was feeling was that there should be some formal education or training in form of some courses. I am going to write to the Dental Council to, incorporate this topic, this subject as a separate subject to be inculcated and to be taught to the students. This will, we are way ahead from others. So we need to have some courses, something like that. So we can have education in a good way. And definitely keeping view the advantages more than the disadvantages, there has been an overwhelming response to, so as to the kind of impression systems we are using and which is fetching us more patients, building a very good rapport with the patient, and communication skills, losses in practice, what we want to do. If you have provision, you have a good inventory, you have good armamentarium, I think nothing more you want, but yes, you want to have a collaborative team approach. You need to have a very good rapport with your lab. As I told you, you need to work as a team. Wherever you go, the mantra is you should work as a team, because together everyone achieves more. So use a combination approach wherever you have a photogrammetric, you want to use an iOS, you want to use a conventional impression, wherever you feel you want to use a combination approach, go for. And yes, I'm quite concerned about the 3DP, 3D printed approaches, wherein we want to save a lot of material. We want to go for layered by layered manufacturing, so as to give a more comfortable and accurate processes as compared to CAM milling. So we, as the time is progressing, you see, we are there again. There has been a paradigm shift from CAD-CAM or CAM to the rapid prototyping or layered additive manufacturing techniques. But yes, I must say this is a magic tool. This is a promising innovation. It is a well integrated approach. It is a ubiquitous tool that can be used, that is being used. And I think we need to have some more further research required. I did an extensive research on this topic, but I feel that further more research is still required to just come up with the predictability of the results, with the innovations. And one day I feel we'll create wonders in the field of dentistry. So with this, I feel it was such a longer topic, and I think I made you feel like this. And if not, then I think I could do some justice to my presentation. So this was something very beautiful. If things aren't failing, that means you are not innovating enough. Definitely in dentistry, in life, we tend to fail. We see failures creep in. But remember, don't lose heart. Don't lose hope. You have to innovate enough. Keep working. Keep fighting, And you have to fight till the end. The fight goes, the struggle goes till the end. And this is how, this was a really wonderful thought, which I wanted to share with you. And we need to, come up with some innovating strategies, and definitely with a positive hope, we'll come up with some another super magic tool, which will definitely do and will take dentistry to the next level, which will take dentistry to greater heights. And that is what my vision is. So thank you very much, folks, for such patient listening. And this is my contact information. Supposedly you feel you want to give some feedback, you want to give some inputs into my presentation, I will be really happy to accept any positive criticism. I will be really happy to accept. You want to add something, you want me, there was something which was not good, I'll definitely improve. There is always a scope for improvement. So in the coming times, if I have been given an opportunity to do the same, I'll definitely will do the same, definitely. So this is my email contact. And last but not the least, it's wholehearted thanks to my very dears Ruben and Siddiqui, the team of Dentist Channel Online. They have really honored me a lot, and it was not possible without them. I wouldn't have been speaking in front of you without them. So a thundering applaud for them too, because they have made it what I wanted to, and they have made it prove well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Arpit. Thank you so much for the lovely session, for your generous words, and for the session which was packed with so much of information. Friends, I'm sure the session was excellent. If you really found it excellent, I want you to write yes, excellent in the chat box. Come on. Each and every one of you can write yes. Thank you, Dr. Shishir. Thank you. Dr. Shishir says it was excellent. Thank you, Dr. Mohorta. Thank you to everyone who's writing excellent. We're so very lucky and so very privileged to have you as our dear participants. It's because of y'all we could have a lovely session today on a special day, which is also Mother's Day today. Dr. Arpit, I request you to kindly stop your screen share for a moment.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry.
Friends, I hope you've noted Dr. Arpit's contact details. If not, we will definitely get it back. Friends, you also have about 2 minutes of your time. You have 2 minutes of your time to quickly note down your questions. Once again, a big thank you to everyone who's written those beautiful comments. Thank you very much. This shows that you all were really, really attentive. Friends, very quickly moving on to what dentistchannel.online is and what we do. As you know, this is the 22nd webinar during the lockdown series, and we are very happy and privileged to have speakers like Dr. Arpit and all the others who've always been there for us, who only have one aim like us, to continue dental education. Thank you very much, Dr. Arpit. Thank you for your lovely time and for your patience and for the wonderful session. Friends, we, dentistchannel.online, we are a dental media company. And the only thing that we request from you is to kindly subscribe to our channels, to subscribe to our YouTube channel, to our Facebook channel, to our Instagram channel, so that you can be in touch with us. You can be in touch with the entire dental fraternity, and you can also get updates on the latest digital technological advancements, because technology, as Dr. Arpit clearly mentioned, is the future of dentistry. And for you to get an insight and an update on the latest from the world of dentistry, I request you to kindly subscribe to Dentist Channel. Please do subscribe if you haven't subscribed. It would just take 30 seconds of your time. Thank you very much. I look forward to being in touch with you always and forever. We also have an official media page, which is called as www.dentistchannel.online. We have an array of articles ranging from oral healthcare to scientific articles. Please do read the articles. Please do share articles if you have written any. They should be really well written, and they should really have power-packed dental information. We can upload it on our platform, giving you due credentials. Please do go through our channel, www.dentistchannel.online. Here's once again a sincere request for you to follow us on our social media pages. A certificate of participation would be only given to you upon your request. For that, you need to message us in the next 5 minutes on the below mentioned WhatsApp number. You need to mention your full name and the name of the webinar that you attended. Today's webinar name and your name. An e-certificate would only be given to you upon your request. Kindly message us as soon as possible. This message is applicable to everyone watching us live on Zoom, on YouTube, and on Facebook. Please do message us on the below mentioned WhatsApp number. This is about the next webinar. We got a lot of inquiries and requests as to come up with a webinar which would help dentists to understand virtual marketing manager softwares. And for that, we've come up with the next webinar on the topic, how to retain your customers with virtual marketing manager. Once again, we have a prolific speaker who would be talking to you about one of the best softwares available in the market. If you're interested to attend this webinar, please register. You can find the registration link in the chat box. And with this, we start with the most important session of the webinar, that is the live question and answer session. So Dr. Arpit, if you're ready, we can start with the question and answer session.
Yes, Ruben, I'm ready.
Thank you very much, sir. Moving on with the first question. First question from Dr. Mansi. Do digital dentures fit better?
Yes, Dr. Mansi. We need to have an integrated approach, as I told you. So generally, as they say, CAD-CAM dentures, if you are, scanning, not going with the scanning of the soft tissues, you are using anatomic measuring devices. If you go into the literature, we have, Dentka company, we have Avadent, and they have a separate set of system. So if you use those anatomic measuring devices, you there and then take the centric relation, you have the final impression with you. After that, you have virtual arrangement, teeth arrangement, everything. So definitely, the CAD-CAM dentures, they do fit in. They have exceptional fit. They have exceptional perception. They have exceptional comfort. And that is how even studies acclaim that there is a very good, between CAD-CAM dentures and conventional dentures. Even if you are doing, certain innovations without the intraoral scanners you are doing. So it's always better to go for a combination approach wherein you are using a conventional impressions with high dimensional stability with an intraoral scan where you cannot scan the soft tissues, the concerns are there. So the studies also say that yes, they do fit in, they are better, and they need to be, they need to be. The only thing is they are the economical concern because they are expensive. Everybody is not able to afford, but yes, even I am just researching upon this topic. So let's see something which is you know, which will help the masses. So let's see how we will be coming up with that technology.
Thank you very much, Dr. Arpit. Moving on to the next question. Question from Dr. Clara from Sweden. This was by far the best presentation I have ever attended on the topic. Thank you for the excellent presentation, Dr. Arpit. My question is, what kind of sterilization protocols are followed on the mouthpiece of the intraoral scanner?
Okay. Now, generally, what do we do is, Dr. Clara, we can't go for the traditional protocols. Okay. That is all done with the conventional impression materials. Okay. What companies or what they say is that you have to only use a disposable plastic sleeve over that. And particularly if you want, you can just scrub some amount of, you know, betadine kind of a thing, or you can just scrub some hypochlorite solution or alcohol based solutions, which is in a concentration of 60 to 70%. So the disinfection currently, what they say is again, not a very effective method, what we do conventionally. So ideally, if you use, one is disposable tips, disposable sleeves, the plastic sleeves, which you are getting, you use that, that is the best part you are doing. Otherwise, if you want to do, because in the current times, you know, we are in the COVID times. So obviously, if you want to do, that is all with the help of some alcohol based solutions, 60 to 70%. And then with the bleaching agents like hypochlorite. And there and then you can rinse and you can go ahead with that. That would give you results, good results.
Thank you very much, Dr. Arpit. Moving on to the next question. Question from Dr. Ramesh. How accurate are the intraoral scanners in an edentulous mouth, particularly in peripheral areas, in terms of border molding?
Yes. They when we talk about border molding, okay. So what do we want? The prime objective in border molding is we are going to record the functional width and depth of the sulcus. So we can't be so sure with intraoral scanners. That is the soft tissue concern. Whenever you are using, what you can do is, the best part is you can make, or if you want to do or go for an integrated approach, you can go for a 3D printed trace wherein that is quite uniform without any distortion. So you can have a replica of 3D trace. You can do border molding conventionally. Okay. And you can use a closed mouth impression technique where you record the VD, you record the eccentric, you have the idea of the jaw relations. And without any phase bows, you can do that, recording the vertical dimension, recording the eccentric, and afterwards, so everything lab will be doing. So virtual arrangement, the final milling, everything lab will be doing. So what you can do, sir, the best part is you have to do border molding by the conventional approach, because you can't, you know, be totally dependable on the scanner that it will scan my soft tissues. You can't be so sure that it is scanning my tissues or my width and depth of the sulcus to that particular extent. So you that is how we are coming up with the conventional or the combination approach. With an integrated approach, we can get better results, the best results, what I feel.
Thank you very much, sir. Moving on to the next question. Question from Dr. Rupanjan Roy. Is this feasible for submucosal fibrosis cases?
Yes, Dr. Ranjan, it is definitely feasible. We did a patient in the same patient having an intraoral opening of around 20 mm. So the, you know, there was a limited mouth opening. Patient on etiology, it was found that that patient had oral submucous fibrosis because of the areca nut chewing. And definitely we used, because nowadays the portable scanners which are coming up, they are not very bulky. They are small in size, so they are easily fitting. But the idea is, now in some patients, they have a very severe you know, mouth opening. They are not able to open the mouth maybe more than 10 mm. So in such patients, it is a concern. But in such patients, what you can do is, first and all, you need to consult your, you know, physician or oral surgeon to just go for mouth opening. And you obviously you tell the patient to go for some exercises for mouth opening. Once in all, you feel that now is it is applicable and now it is very convenient for my scanner to go in. Because till 20 mm we have used that scanner and it was going perfectly well. We got beautiful pictures with that scans. But yes, if you have to go with the severity of the case. If it is too severe, then scanner will not go in. So first check the etiology. You have to remove the offending agent. You have to go with the mouth opening exercises, and it will take some time. Do multiple follow-ups, and then in, if you feel it is quite convenient, it is quite portable for the scanner to move in, yes, you can go with that. And that will do wonders. We have done that. It will definitely do the best for you.
Thank you very much, sir. Moving on to the next question. Very common question. What is the best scanner available today, and what is the cost of the scanner?
Okay. Till now, the best scanner, I would feel, now with due respect to every scanner, I'm not promoting any company, but it's just to say what I have seen, Trios 3 shape. I feel Trios is doing wonderfully well. Why? Because it is quite portable. The scanning accuracy is fast. It is more because it is based on the confocal laser principle. So the scanning, it captures multiple images, maybe 3000 images in micro images in 1 second. So many images are formed, they are superimposed. The accuracy is exceptional. And definitely it is doing wonders as far as we are coming up with more lab scanners also, which are very well equipped, and they are more handy, portable. The cost may be around 30 lakhs. So generally, when we talk about the scanners, it usually starts from 8 or 9 lakhs to maybe some 30 or 35 lakhs. So it is maybe around 30 lakhs and plus only. So that is quite expensive. The only reason is that there are so many functions available. You have functions to record hard tissue, soft tissue. You have so many controls. The software is now, the software which is coming up is really good. It is really effective. Earlier, what used to happen was the scanners, we had. Na? So what happened, the scanners, they had an STL file transfer. So that STL file transfer used to take around 30-40 minutes to transfer and send it to the lab. But here in Trios and, coming up with such good scanners, we in no time, maybe in 1 or 2 minutes, you are able to send the STL file or the OBG file of your data to your lab personnel. So there are so many software, good tools, wherein you have a broad horizon. So the software is good. The scanner is good. The softwares are really good. And Trios is coming up with the beautiful multifunctionalities for other aspects also. As I was talking about the shade match, as I was talking about the other mandibular movements. So, it's a wide horizon. And when we have something in everything, I think we should go for that. That's a good, above all, if you afford to invest, you can go with, that's the best scanner, I feel.
Thank you very much, sir. Moving on to the next question. Question from Dr. Nikhil. What kind of service and maintenance is required in a scanner?
Okay, Dr. Nikhil. Well, the maintenance is actually done by the manufacturer, the service and manufacturer, the maintenance. See, whatever technology is associated with any kind of maintenance. Okay. So there are frequent intervals when, and as and when the manufacturer, supposedly you have taken from any manufacturer, they come in, they repeatedly check the accuracy. Now, when you have to check the accuracy, obviously there have been so many studies just to check the accuracy, whether it's going well, either it is scanning well or not. So serviceability and maintenance is done as per record by the company people, the manufacturer, wherein they have to write it out. It's just like a servicing, you are doing it for any, any AC, any other equipment you are doing. So that is, the whole thing is maintained. There is a record for that. Okay. And definitely that is why they are incurring you charges. You have cost of the equipment and then you have maintenance of the equipment. So the data record is with the company also. And that is how your data is secured. And basically the people from that particular company, they try to maintain. And that is the cost of the data coming up to you. Right.
Thank you very much, sir. Moving to the next question. Question from Dr. Teresa Jose. Subgingival preparations. Can you guide us with digital impression?
Okay. When you want to go for subgingival preparation, the only idea is behind the success of any, FPD, FDP, and any restoration is to record the finish line. Okay. You need to have a marginal placement, which should be good.
if you have a good marginal placement, it will lead to success of your processes. There will be, you know, if there is some marginal misfit, it can lead to some periodontal problems. It can lead to some caries defects. Other things will fall on. Okay. So the best part is whenever you are going with the scanner, make sure you are using retraction cords, either single, either double, whatever way you are, you know, comfortable with. If not, you can use cordless system, magic foam cord, Expecel. There are so many paste systems, astringents, so many systems which are available, you know, for the gingival retraction. Anyways, when you are doing it, keep in mind, you are doing the same for the conventional impression materials. So you have to give respect to the gingival tissues. Make sure you are not traumatizing. Okay. And once in and all, you are using the intra retraction medicaments. You have maintained, you have suitably dried the area, because the gingival fluids, they tend to creep in. So you have to also make sure that proper retraction with proper instruments, armamentarium, and creating a suitable operating dry field with no moisture, with the less of the less saliva, drying it. That's the best part. That is the same what you are doing for the conventional impression materials. The idea behind it is whenever you do it, in fact, if you are doing it in a wet field, the saliva, the moisture, any blood, any food debris, you know, that tends to blur your image with the intraoral scan, or that will give you a very hazy image. So try, give sufficient time, just relax. Sufficient time needs to be given. And I feel there and then when you are doing it, you are well versed with the retraction techniques, with that retraction approach. I think the best part is once retraction is done, and there and then you start with the scanning part. So that whenever gingival fluid later on creeps in, you have already scanned that particular area. So that is the immediate aspect, what you can feel in. Okay.
Thank you very much, sir. Moving to the next question. Question from Dr. Maheshwaran. How useful is digital impression for removable prosthodontics, especially since resiliency of soft tissue cannot be recorded?
Yes, doctor. It's again... Again, a soft tissue concern with us. What I told you, that hard tissues, they can be easily scanned. Okay. We used to, you know, read about the principles as per the Pascal's law, the mucocompressive, mucostatic, selective pressure impression theories. So there are certain things, you know, which plays a role in response to the fluid dynamics. So our mucoperiosteum is again the same, which is following those particular laws. So the thing is, what you can do is you can use a 3D printed custom tray. One is this, okay? What you can do is you can make impression, do border molding, as I just told you, do border molding, recording the functional width and depth of the sulcus. That is how you're using the conventional means in integration with the digital approaches. So that is how, what we can do is, we can come up with a combination approach again. We can make impressions with the selective pressure technique, what we are doing conventionally. Okay. And with this, we are using a closed mouth impression technique. We are making rims, and there and then, you know, with the established vertical dimension and centric, we can there and then record. And this thing over the cast, you know, this whole thing with secondary impression and with JR or jaw relation recorded, you can directly transfer to the lab. Now the lab person will put in this particular kind of a thing into a lab scanner or a desktop scanner. This will scan the whole thing, and you will remove into the program, you will remove the rim part, and you will get an idea of where my you know, virtual teeth arrangement has to be done. Once in and all it is done, it goes for milling, and ultimately you know, with the finished dentures or computer engineered complete dentures, your 3D dentures, you can give it to the processes with maximal comfort. So the idea is, wherever you feel like incomplete dentures, always go for a combination approach with conventional impression techniques, as well as with the intraoral scan approach or extraoral scan approach.
Thank you very much, sir. Moving to the next question. Question from Dr. Rabinder. Excellent presentation and a lot of information.
Thank you.
Thanks to you, Dr. Arpit. Please indicate absolute values of accuracy obtained and permissible deviations, if any.
Yes. So we generally, whenever we talk in terms of you know, accuracy, we generally use the terms accuracy, trueness, precision. I found so many studies when they were comparing you know, Trios, Carestream 3600, Medit 500, and so on. There are so many manufacturers, okay, with due respect to every manufacturer and company. So I was saying that whenever you check the accuracy, now accuracy is generally checked with a tested model. They have a model with them. And this model, you know, that's particularly a research study. You check the model with maybe some implant, with maybe a brass dye with a prepared crown. Okay. So that is a stable dye wherein you check, you scan, and with different scanners, you have a picture of all scanners now. Okay. So supposedly I want to compare Trios and Carestream. Okay. So I'll mark the coordinates. I'll mark the areas. Supposedly I want to check the inter-implant distance. Okay. I have superimposed the CBCT data. I want to check. Okay, the scanning has been done. So I'll mark all the coordinates with a number. I'll mark the number of coordinates. So I'll take a mean value, and that is how I'll check the mean and standard deviation values. And that is how I'll go about with the other scanner on and on. There have been studies where the accuracy and predictable values have been checked with maybe more than 7 intraoral scanners. So that is how, this is all research-based studies which are again going on. And that's a very good question, because whatever we are doing is all based on the accuracy of any intraoral scanner. So yes, we can do that. We can do particularly. And if you are interested also, you can, you know, go for some research study for the same. That is again good. Here we can, you know, check such kind of processes with this. With angular deviations, we also check one thing. Whenever we are checking with the scan bodies, we check, are there any linear deviations or there are some angular displacements? So that depends the kind of dye you have made, the kind of processes, the kind of research topic you want to take, or this is all as per your interest, even if you want to do. So I encourage you, you should do this thing also. If you can, definitely you should go about it, and I'll help you out in this. So the best part is, even if you are giving an implant, so you tend to check the measurements for implant also. You check all the coordinates, you check the displacement values, and when you check any discrepancy, supposedly you are checking the marginal discrepancy, also you check the mean value. So the very less of the less marginal discrepancy means you have a more, likewise, just on a layman term, that means you have a more accurate intraoral scan with you.
Thank you very much, sir. A few more questions. Yeah. Next question from Dr. Yash Madan. Can digital impression be taken in case of flabby ridges?
A very good question, Dr. Yash. In flabby ridges, the idea is that we have a displaceable, movable tissue. Okay. So the intraoral scans, what best you can do is you make impressions with the alginate. Okay. Or with some suitable material, which would not lead to displaceability of the tissue. We want to record any tissue which is there mucostatically. It should be intimately recorded, because we need to respect the displaceable soft tissues also. So the kind of thing you are doing with intraoral scanner, since it is not very well, you know, going well with the soft tissue scanning, what you can do is you can make preliminary impression with alginate, irreversible hydrocolloid. You have a cast with you. You just scan that cast into an optical scanner. You can make a 3D printed custom tray. Okay. Once you make a 3D printed custom tray, there and then only you can make holes on that. Once you are designing the tray, you can there and then make holes, or you can go for some windowed kind of an approach, whatever kind of technique you are going to use, whether it's a window technique, you are going for Zafrullah Khan technique. There are so many techniques for that. Okay. You have suitable impression materials with you, which are elastomers, obviously. So you can go for maybe border molding with polyether, and then you can go for this secondary impression with the medium body silicone. Once in, again, what do you do? Now you have a secondary impression, or what you can do, you can either record it in a light body also, medium body, light body, a monophase combination. It should be stable and it should respect the soft displaceable tissues. Now you have an elastomeric impression material, which is stable enough. It is quite stable. What you can do is, there is a provision for impression scanning also. You take that impression, you send it to a lab, obviously after disinfecting and using all those protocols, the impression will be scanned. This impression scanning, which is done, is giving you a desired width, depth of the functional sulcus. And apart from that, much above that, your tissues soft displaceable tissues are recorded in a very good condition. So whatever you have recorded, now you have a scanner with you, which will scan the elastomer impression material, which is edentulous from a flabby ridge. So it will scan, it will give you a virtual model. So on that particular model, you can go ahead with the jaw relation, and later on you can go with again with a combined integrated approach with that. But as far as intraoral scan is concerned for displaceable tissues, its efficacy is not really, you know, it's not good. It has not been actually read. So this can again be taken up as a research study. That's again a good question by you, Dr. Madan. So we can do that also. So best part is go for a combined approach. That will be a good thing for the success of the final processes.
Thank you, Dr. Arpit, for answering to the question. Next question from Dr. Ritu Sharma. First of all, I want to thank you, Dr. Arpit, for enlightening us with your vast knowledge on the topic. My question is, what is ultrasonic impression technique and what are the benefits over other digital technologies?
Okay. Dr. Ritu, that's a very good question by you. And the ultrasonic emission technique, the principles of ultrasonics, we say it depends on the vibrational principles or the sound principles. So generally the idea was, whenever we were recording the impressions with intraoral scan, there were some problems to control moisture, to, you know, control the isolation, to maintain a dry field. The idea was that you need to go for some ultrasound impression which could record effectively the subgingival areas, even if we have a wet field. Now, I'll tell you, in some patients, you can't control the salivation part. There are certain patients who are medically compromised or maybe having some problems with hypersalivation. So what you can do is, the best part is, if you feel like this, since this research area is not much researched upon, so the best part is you can go with some ultrasonic impression tips. There are certain tips which can just scan with the sound acoustic analysis, sound impedance analysis. So based on that, that gives you a pretty clear view of what you want to do. And definitely it is better over digital impressions when you are talking about the subgingival tooth preparations. And this also matters if you have a gingival biotype that is thick or thin. If it is, till now the research says that if it is a thin gingival biotype, it is good. The ultrasonic waves can actually perceive through the thin tissue biotype. If it's a thick tissue biotype, the answer is again, it remains unanswered because of the researchers. Much of the research has not been done on this topic. So definitely it has benefits. Particularly the benefit, till now what we know, the benefit is in concern with the subgingival preparation. But I would suggest to you, whenever you are going with the, you know, full mouth or fixed partial processes, when you are doing with the going with the tooth preparation, I told you, always start with the conventional approach. It's not that we don't want to go for, now we have a very good technology with us and now we don't want to go for something which is conventional. So once you are, you know, you are the masters in the conventional impression techniques, the retraction techniques, you are a master to it, go for and apply as and when required. Once in, you go for it, you try to use any technology, either it's irrespective of, either it's intraoral scan, either it's ultrasonic impression tips. But yes, particularly till now, what the research says, what the documentation has been done, the ultrasonic impression tips, they are doing wonders, particularly for a thin gingival tissue biotype for subgingival tooth preparations. We'll be coming up with more such articles also. As and when, if somehow I'll be coming up with such articles or documentations, I'll definitely tell you and I'll mail you for that.
So thank you very much, sir. Moving on to the next question. Question from Dr. Kevin Peter Gonzalez. Sir, what is your take on using an intraoral scanner for an impression during the COVID-19 era?
Okay. Dr. Kevin, yes, that's a good question. Well, as per we know, impression is not a very emergent, it's not an emergent procedure. Okay, in dentistry, as per the guidelines, what we say, we have to just resort to the emergency procedures. Okay, I feel if I say it's SS opening emergency or some impaction, something like that, irrespective of that, we take prostodontics as not into any emergency. So I feel that you should take in to much elective procedures till the time COVID is there. respecting everybody. Make sure any patient comes up to you for, even if you are doing some patients or OPDs, so try to resort to the emergency procedures only. You take up or defer your patients for such elective procedures to a, you know, to some date or some time and further moving ahead whenever you feel that COVID would not be into picture. So my idea is the impressions and intraoral scans, particularly at this point of time, they shouldn't be used. And you don't know. And I must say, the Center of Disease Control, CDC regulations, they also say that treat every patient as a COVID patient. We don't know what is there in the patient's mouth. And, you know, we as dental surgeons, we are quite at a larger risk and we are at a higher risk as compared to any other professional. So respecting you with that, I respect the patients. I respect the thoughts of whatever has been the guide. We have to actually follow the guidelines. But likewise, you need to maintain, if you have an intraoral impression, if you have the OPD, you try, and sometime you can just maintain that. In this period, you can do other jobs and try to maintain with the disinfection protocols with that. So I personally feel that you should avoid, you shouldn't go for the intraoral scan impressions in this, keeping in view the non-emergent procedure. In current prevailing outbreak situations, we should save our patients, we should save ourselves from any cross-contamination.
Thank you, sir. Last three questions.
Yeah.
Next question, isolation control. How exactly to isolate and get dry field before scanning?
Okay. So generally we have so many things. If you are operatory, if you have, you know, cotton rolls, generally they are used. You have gauze pieces, then high volume suction if you have. Now, I prefer personally that we need to have a four-handed dentistry. If you have an assistant with you, it's good. Sometimes there are situations when you don't have, you are doing a single-handed dentistry, and that is a big problem. So as and when, generally the best thing is a rubber dam isolation, but you can't go for that because you are making impression of the other areas also. So the best part is you try and you see whether your patient has hypersalivation or your patient has a mucous saliva, serous saliva, any kind. You need to classify your patient first. What kind of secretions your patient has, you need to classify. And once you classified, try to take the medical history because of, hypersalivation. In case it is any related to any medical history, you know, need to go about it. Okay. And if you feel like, then you have to, you know, give some tablets to the patient, anticholinergic drugs, as we say, hypersalivation. So as to have a dry field half an hour before, we say medications can be given. You can go for the best part is what I feel is, again, isolation, what we are doing conventionally. You can take a cotton piece. Simultaneously, you can tell the patient, if you don't have provision or 400 industry, you can simultaneously tell your patients to just hold the, you know, suction tips or high volume vacuum suctions, and therein, that will be the best thing, and go for retraction cords with suitable medicaments. The cord is giving the best result, what I feel. Till now, studies also claim that you can go in for a single or a double cord for maybe 8 to 10 minutes into this. Use a good kind of retraction medicament. Okay, that is again, you know, 25% buffered aluminum chloride you can use. That is again has a possibly less chances of any side effects. So once and all you have done with the retraction, you feel your field is quite free of moisture or any other, you know, debris or the blood or any other gingival fluid, because gingival fluid can again come in and can again percolate into the preparation. So you need to be very skillful. You need to be really fast to scan the subgingival impression. Till now, ultrasonic or ultrasound tooth principles, we are not using, because it is, again, it has just started off and it has been just patented. But in dentistry, it comes as a magic nod. We don't exactly, even I don't know, because much of the research has to be done. So my take is that whenever you have done using suitable conventional retraction principles, once you have done, and the same way you are removing the retraction cord, be very alert, be very particular, be really fast and skillful in preparing or scanning the area first starting, supposedly you have a 4-6 with you. Okay. You have a 4-6 and 4-6 is prepared for a single crown. Okay. You have a 4-7, 4-8. So you start once and all the retraction is done beautifully. You are confident enough that I am able to achieve my field. Isolation is done. You start with 4-8 coming to 4-7 and very rapidly into a zigzag fashion, you start with 4-6 preparation. And in no time, because I told you a time factor is very important. I think gingival fluids again take maybe 2 to 3 minutes to again come and proceed into the subgingival preparation. So you need to be fast there and then you remove retraction cord or any other cord system you are using. Try to use a retraction cord with a suitable retraction medicament. Remove it. And as soon as you have removed, you have just aspirated, you have just dried again the field, you start with the impression scanning. And definitely, if possible, try to go for a four-handed dentistry because you will be needing much help in that. But if not, then your patient will help you a lot, what I feel. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Moving to the next question. Question from Dr. Harshit Lohani. I love the session so much. Thanks a lot for providing us such an informative session. My question is, can it replace the conventional method of using impression material for taking impression completely?
Dr. Harshit, up till now, see, we are again dependent on the conventional impression materials. There is something. See, we don't have to be too much practical on saying that now we have some good technology. So we are not, you know, we are not concerned with the older technologies. I have seen, as you say, old is gold. So I feel the conventional impression materials, if they are old, they are gold since today. So they are gold standard. See, you can't go for intraoral scanning of the soft tissues alone. So yes, you are still dependent on the, you know, the conventional impression techniques and methods. If done, yes, till now, we can't replace the conventional impression systems. And I think in the future to come, we won't be able to replace. That is what I feel. That is my perception. So whenever you use an intercombination of the principles, techniques, materials, see, every technique, every material in life, in nature, I think nothing is ideal. So how can we say that intraoral scanners are ideal to us? So I feel the everything is related with some flaws. As I told you about the disadvantages, there are so many potential advantages of intraoral scans. And apart from that, we are seeing, you know, some these disadvantages again with us. In spite of that, the technology is rapidly growing. And still we feel that, you know, we are again dependent on the combination approaches, what I told you. We are, nowadays, we are researching more on the digital dentures as to how to scan the elastomeric impression material. So how can we say that we can remove completely the conventional impression materials and techniques? We are still dependent. And supposedly, if we completely remove it, then I think we would be experiencing so much failures into dentistry. And once in all, everything has advantages, everything has disadvantages. So we need to find out. I mean, that is the positive approach. One person who is positive sees a positive thing from a negative person also. So that is how we have to keep in view, keep in mind the disadvantages of the conventional impression materials. We try to rectify. There have been potential advancements and innovations in conventional impression techniques and materials. So making use of the potential advantages of that, and in combination with the intraoral scan or with the CAS scan, or, you know, technology is good at its place and going with a good pace. But I feel that there should be no complete innovation or elimination of the conventional impression materials. That is a due respect to the older technologies also. We need to respect old is gold philosophy. I think will continue even in near future. So wherever possible, use an integrated approach, use a combined approach, wherever you feel like, particularly in computer engineered complete dentures, those are the 3D printed dentures, wherein you can't move, you know, you can't go for a fabrication of complete denture. Supposedly you scan a soft tissue and you are scanning the edentulous arches. I feel with only intraoral scan, I will not be able to give a denture which fits in, which is really comfortable. How can I feel? It may be overextended, it may be underextended. How can you be so sure? So we have to take support, we have to take help of the conventional impression techniques and use it to the fullest extent. And with this concluding remarks, I would say that, as I told you, you need to be a king. You need to be a master of the conventional impressions too. It's not the some technology is coming up. And what I was telling you about the formal education, we are telling our kids, our students, to learn more about the digital scan systems. Now, if they are not well versed with the conventional impressions, how can they use and, you know, use those integrated approaches? So you have to respect the conventional technologies wherein and wherever possible, use the conventional technologies with the digital impression technology. So that is how fits in the success of our clinical practices. We can't remove or completely eliminate the old faithful. I would give a term. It is to the conventional impression materials. Personally, I feel they are old faithful impressions. So how can a faithful impression can be rectified or neglected? We shouldn't neglect. We need to respect both a combination of conventional and digital impression approaches.
Thank you, Dr. Arpit. That brings us to the end of the live question and answer session. Thank you to all the participants for your wonderful messages and for your thank you messages. They really mean a lot to Dr. Arpit. I'm sure they mean a lot to him. They mean a lot to us as well. That shows us that you all were really attentive. We are really thankful to each and every one of you. That brings us to an end. We wish you a happy day. Thank you, and may you all have a good day.
Thank you.